and welcome back to the Wednesday Morning Hump Day Café here on CMRC Radio, available around the world at cmrcradio.ca. And that was In Sync with Bye Bye Bye. And before that, that was a production of, by our very own broadcasting students, of a production of Psycho in 10 Minutes. That was with Chris McKay, Ashley Ostrander, Luke Smith, Laura Moser, and I'm forgetting the last person here, which I am going to get in trouble with that person very, very... Oh, yeah, Kirby Loop, also known as KJ Loops here. Now, let's get into the really, really important stuff now, which is the panel on It Gets Better. And currently this morning, joining me in studio is the president of the organization Gay Friends in Calgary, Bill Taylor. Good morning, Bill.
Good morning. How are you?
And I'm doing very well. And Cristofer Chan, who is a psychology student here at Mount Royal University. Good morning, Chris.
Good morning.
And we have Brian Singh. Brian, you just came in, so didn't have enough time for some introductions. So would you be able to introduce yourself a little bit here?
Oh, sure. I am the president and managing director of Zinc Research, a polling company here in Calgary.
All right. Fantastic. So just to give you a quick... a backgrounder for those who are not familiar with the Trevor Project or It Gets Better. It was a project that was started after the suicide of Tyler Clementi, who was a student, about 18-year-old student, who was caught having intimate relationships. Trying to use the sort of the weasel words here. It is still early in the morning, so, and who knows who's going to be listening. So that's why. So he was caught, and of course he committed suicide, and that followed with another rash of suicides. And of course, a number of celebrities have come out on with YouTube videos saying, "Hey, it does get better." This is my sort of way. My sort of way to say to all you listening out there who are having some questions, yeah, that it does get better. So. Let's, of course, that segues into our first question. That gets into our first question. What was life like for you guys? Who wants to start? Don't be shy, guys. Come on.
You know, let's go with the one with the most experience.
All right. Go ahead, Bill.
Basically, John, that means I'm the oldest person in the room.
Oh, that's a nice way to put it, for sure.
I said it very nicely.
So, I grew up in rural Alberta, a very, very small community. A one-room school, 30 kids, and I was the token fag. I was beat up. I was picked on. I was ostracized. I was always the last kid picked to go on the team. I left there. I chose to... I became involved. I grew up in a religion that was exceedingly homophobic. I grew up with a society that believed you had to live a straight life. You had to conform or you weren't worthwhile. And so I did. I tried to pretend. And it got me a lot of trouble for a long, long time. And now it's someone else's turn.
All right. All right. Go ahead, Chris.
All right. Well, my experience is quite different. I'm a lot younger, and times have definitely changed. Mm-hmm. Growing up, there was always a little bit of homophobia around, but it wasn't quite so extreme. Things were a lot more, people were a lot more accepting in the late 80s and early 90s. And at that time, I wasn't really out of the closet, so it wasn't something that was salient to my classmates or, you know, the people around me, aside from at that age, especially. But one thing that was, and I think will always be, a big part of dealing with being gay is that it's not quite the same thing as being a minority where you're, you know, of a different ethnic background. I mean, I'm a visual minority. I'm an Asian. But one thing about being gay is that it's something that you don't share with your parents or your family. So there's problems at home that occur because you don't have that sort of sense of, well, I'm proud and I'm Asian, I'm proud and I'm black and my family taught me it's okay, because in a lot of situations, your family doesn't teach you it's okay. You know, they don't even know about it. You have to come out to them. And so that was definitely difficult for me dealing with my family. There were some peers at school that weren't quite so accepting, but not quite to the extent that Bill's experience was. But it was definitely hard for me. And it wasn't just a struggle with my peers and with my family. It was a struggle with myself. Very, very difficult to be the different one, even if it isn't in such an extreme situation.
Mm-hmm, for sure. Sure. And of course, Chris, you and I are both, I believe you were both of the same visual minority. I mean, I'm Chinese. I believe you're also Chinese as well, too.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. So, I mean, I do have a similar sort of experience. But again, I'll get into mine a little bit more if I have some time. But Brian, what about yourself?
Well, I tend to fall right down the middle between these two guys in terms of age, but I am also a visible minority, too, but I do feel like I cover a lot more quotas. I am an immigrant. I moved to Canada first in 1980. I'm originally from Trinidad and Tobago. I was also raised in a Muslim household, and visible minority, Muslim, and immigrant. I think I have covered hitting all the quotas here, aren't I?
Oh, yeah, you are. Like, you've got all of them here.
But, you know, growing up in Trinidad, I think that, realizing I was gay at a young age, and also I was quite fortunate that my parents valued education. I was in a very enriched educational environment, academic environment, I should say more correctly. And I think that gave me a lot of will to plot my actions as an adult. And I think that growing up with my mom and the influence of being East Indian and the pressure to get married and have children at a very young age, that once I finished university and my first degree, the pressure really turned up. And that was a bit challenging, and it did put a wedge between me and my parents. My rest of my family were generally supportive, and I'm very thankful for having a family that has an academic bent, because obviously education does actually support many other means other than just a living. It also does support a more open mind, and that was very helpful. But once the parents knew, then there was a whole range of different challenges. And I've been out to my family, my parents now. Well, actually, my dad died a few years ago, but over 20 years now.
Oh wow, that's still good. So, but you were able to cope. So your family was quite understanding in this case then for that problem. That's probably a good way to sum that up then. Or
Like I said, when you do have an educated family, it is a incredible help to actually get them along the path.
All right. Well, that actually now brings us to about 9:41. I guess I probably should be able to get into mine own actually. So, well, I personally, how do I start? It seems like a long time ago here. So, I think I'm the youngest of the. I feel like I'm the youngest of the bunch here. I'm currently 26. I know it's not a number I try to bandy about very much. Anyway, that's a whole different matter. I mean, I've started exploring myself at about 15, and honestly, I'm still on that path right now. So, like, I'm still on that road here. I'm just literally blown away at some of the stories that I hear from everybody else that is around me, and of course from the stories that are coming from this panel here right now. So, I mean, I personally started exploring, and I first the first person that knew about me. I told the first person at 19. So, I mean, I'm still on that road. I mean, some of my colleagues here have been extremely accepting here at CMRC Radio. And my family is getting to that point here. That's still a work in progress. So, I mean, everybody's at a different rate. But again, though, I found my voice on radio, and I've been able to express my voice. And welcome back to the Wednesday Morning Hump Day Café here on CMRC Radio, available around the world at cmrcradio.ca. And with us still in studio right now is Bill Taylor from the organization Gay Friends in Calgary, Mount Royal student Cristofer Chan, and the president of,
Singh Research.
Singh Research, Brian Singh. And we are now in our second section of our It Gets Better discussion. So think of it as a It Gets Better video on radio. So, with that said in mind, of course, you're listening to the Wednesday Morning Hump Day Cafe here on CMRC Radio. Current time is 9:47 a.m. We are going to be going into our second section, which is advice. So, I mean, everybody gets awesome pieces of advice, or maybe not so awesome pieces of advice about when during our experiences. So right now we're going to talk. So again, people are so people may not be ready when someone either comes out to them, or they're not ready to come out themselves, or maybe say not accepting of themselves. So advice. What sort of advice did you guys get that weren't so good, that were pretty good, that weren't so good, and what you would share? So who wants to go ahead with this one?
I think I'll jump in here.
Fantastic. Thanks, Cristofer. Well,
basically, one thing that I do want us to remember is that we live in North America. It's a very individualistic society, and stepping away from your family and trying to become autonomous and define who you want to be and your own goals is a lot more accepted here than in other parts of the world. A lot of people, even if their families are vehemently against their homosexuality, are maybe even encouraged to move away and start a life, you know, elsewhere, away from their family, you know, and their family may never even know. It's a very, very different system here in North America. One thing that really, really helped me is... because, you know, my family wasn't very accepting of me. And one thing that really helped me was just, you know, stepping away and realizing that, you know, at some point I have to think about making myself happy instead of my family happy. And if I, you know, there was a choice between doing what my mother wanted me to do mm-hmm. and doing something that would enable me to find what I've been wanting to find for a long time. And that was, you know, love with, you know, people who I want to love. So mm-hmm. That was basically the big stepping point for whether when it went from bad to it's going to get better.
Oh, fantastic. And who else wants to jump in on this one? Brian?
Go ahead here. I was back in, I think it was 1983, I was doing pretty badly at university, and obviously there were a whole range of issues here. I'm 19 years old, and you know, my hormones are going crazy. I was very fortunate to have a family friend, and he lived in Montreal, and he was a psychologist, and you know, went there, spent a whole weekend, kind of, you know, bawled my eyes out and, you know, opened up my heart. And what I learned out of it was I really had to work on myself first. And that was the most important thing. And, you know, being the 80s and, you know, obviously with the whole issue of AIDS becoming rampant and also with a lot of misinformation and also misunderstanding, it was actually a pretty good time to actually work on myself. So I really plotted my career, spent a lot more time on that. It was not necessarily just going out for love and, you know, just going out, getting acquainted with the gay community a lot, because at the end of the day, you still have to make have a career and, you know, make money. I went on to grad school and then I, you know, really got focused on my career because I knew that I had to stand independently. Mm-hmm. I also had to be able to have a voice on my own so that when I had to deal with issues of family and my parents and mm-hmm. also the relatives, at least I had a voice. I knew that I could stand on my own and mm-hmm. be firmly independent no matter whatever came down the pipe.
Mm-hmm. So, Brian, you probably were saying, so something you'd probably be saying just to sort of wrap up the little point here, so that you find someone who you can trust, so like the rock of support. Is that probably the gist of what you're saying in this case?
You know, tap into your trust network.
All right. Bill, did you want to go ahead before I go ahead?
Absolutely.
Go ahead.
The 1988, the year of the Olympics, my marriage ended. AIDS was a major crisis at the time in this city.
Huge, yeah.
And I met a couple, a gay couple, and I was exceedingly depressed. I felt like a total failure. My marriage had failed. I'd lost a business. I felt totally, totally worthless. And in this couple, one of the partners had been married, a bit older than me. He had grown children. And they invited me to their home one night, and they talked about how life changed for them eventually, about the good communication they had with their children, and about the good communication they even had with his former wife. And the exact words they said to me were, "It gets better."
Wow. Even way back then, so... And of course, here you are now, Bill. I mean, it's been, wait, 22 years now on and it's gotten better for you. I mean, you're the head of the one of the biggest LGBT organizations here in Calgary. I mean, I think you guys run different things. We'll talk a little bit more in our third section, of course. One of the advice, so again, sorry, I'm hoping I wasn't cutting in. I mean, did anything? All right. Well, right now, one of the pieces of advice that I got when the person I told, so her name was at the University of Calgary at that time here, they're pretty basic. It was be yourself. I mean, but at that time, I was really, really uptight. I mean, I was not exactly. You guys, during when Neil Young was playing, of course, you saw the little stressful side of me. That's probably some part of me that's never going away. But there's always this uptight side to me that's still here and there. I mean, my last host got a little bit of that earlier this morning at about 8 a.m. this morning. So, but that's just like the, you know what, part. But that's one thing that was told was just relax, literally relax, be yourself, and don't be afraid. I got that many, many times. I mean, that's one of the things. I mean, Cristofer, you touched on it, is that being an Asian person, I mean, there's this individualistic sort of seed. It's just simply not there, right? So it's like you just have to conform. I mean, one of the things that I remember, I was just at the dinner at the Sinlock dinner, which I actually emceed a couple weeks ago. Was that one of the guys that when I told them that I was actually a broadcaster, they said, "What? That's so un-Asian of you in jest." Seriously, that's what he said. You're a broadcaster? Like aren't you supposed to be like a doctor or a lawyer, an accountant or something? And I literally just almost laughed my head off. But literally, but it's that the point that the guy, after he spoke to me like that, it just hits home. I mean, even today, it just hits home. Like, really? I mean, and that's one of the reasons why I chose to be in broadcasting as well, too. Not only can I express myself in different ways, but also break away from that niche that as well, too. So that, I mean, I'm not an accountant. I'm horrible at math. I don't want to be cutting up people up, so I don't want to be a doctor. Again, I don't like numbers, so I don't want to be an accountant. And so, again, being myself and also relax, two different things. And my guest last week, Lady Serafina, came in. And, of course, one of the pieces of advice that she also did is that, well, it does, and again, like something that Bill just alluded to as well, it does get better. I mean, and work on yourself. That's another thing that Brian mentioned as well, too. So, and all the advice that I've gotten as well, too, I mean, I'm one of those people that do need a little bit of extra advice here and there. But again, that's just me. And all of the pieces that you guys have gotten seems like that we all get the same as well, too. But now that, of course, leads to the quick question. We have about another couple minutes here before we go to our next break. What sort of advice would you give to someone who is dealing with, maybe someone who is trying to come out or having some troubles coming out? What sort of advice would you guys give?
I guess.
Go ahead.
Right. You know, I speak to a very different audience here, and I'd like to speak to a different audience. The immigrant kids, those who are coming from visible minorities, but those who I know, like, everybody's going to have a challenge, but they're going to have an additional challenge given the culture. Really, you know, find your voice, step outside of your community, and find things such as this radio station. I know one of the things I did in university was I too was on at the university radio station, and it was very helpful in me exploring my voice, and it was also exceptionally helpful in my career. And so again, step outside of yourself. I know that there's lots of resources out there. I know Bill could talk to that, but really find your voice and work on that, and define who you are, and get really comfortable with that, because it's going to give you a lot of strength to deal with anything else coming along in the future.
All right. And Bill, Crystal?
Something that has been very evident to me is that one of the things we sometimes overlook is that each of us is our own person, and we are so much more than just gay.
Thank you.
Being gay is just a facet of who we are.
Now, that brings us to about 9:59 a.m. We have one more section here. So this is the section where we're going to be talking about how you can, so if you need some extra assistance, where you can turn to. So, gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to fire up a little bit more music. I've been playing them for all morning here, and they'll be here on March 31st. The B-52s, they'll be at the Century Casino. One of my absolute favorite bands, and another one of my favorite tracks from them is "Too Much to Think About," from their most recent CD, Funplex. So you're listening to CMRC Radio, available around the world at cmrcradio.ca. Of course, sorry, just for those who are listening right now, I'm expecting the sick show with Cecilia. She is away this week, so I have actually taken over. So it is this still will be the Wednesday morning Hump Day Café until 12 o'clock when Brian Allen takes over. But anyway, here we go. B-52s, you're listening to CMRC Radio, available around the world at cmrcradio.ca. And welcome back to the Wednesday Morning Hump Day Cafe here on cmrcradio.ca, available around the world at cmrcradio.ca. Of course, did not know why I completely repeated myself. Probably it's because it's getting a little bit later in the morning. Usually this is the time where I would sign off and handle Cecilia, but again, no, she is in Mexico, so lucky her. So I'm just crashing in sort of pseudo-retribution. I'm just crashing her show until 12 o'clock. So there we go. So that actually gives us a little extra time. So another one more section on my very special panel on It Gets Better. And of course, still with us in the studio, Brian Singh from Zinc Research, Cristofer Chan, a student here at Mount Royal University, and the president of Gay Friends in Calgary, Bill Taylor. Good morning, guys.
Good morning again.
All righty here. So with that said in mind, we have we're going on to our final topic. Where you can turn to, what places can you go to get some more help, to help get more advice, and so places, people, places and things, what we've seen, what available are in Calgary. So with that said in mind, who wants to go ahead?
Apparently I just got elected.
Yeah. We're going anti-clockwise here with the microphones.
There are tremendous resources available in Calgary, first of all. Sometimes when approaching your issues around being gay, maybe a little counseling wouldn't hurt. There are resources. I don't have them on immediately available, but one source would possibly be Calgary Family Services. There are also a tremendous number of people deal with religious issues. There are some organizations who have an arm that has a gay outreach portion to it. Look them up. Find them if those are the issues that you personally are dealing with. But there are other sources. One of the most fulfilling sources is friends. Finding friends. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. What a job. And I don't recommend the bars as the first place to hunt for friends.
That's right.
Yeah, that's a recipe for disaster
right
there.
You just find
there.
Alcoholics here, right?
But there are all kinds of personal interest things available in the gay community. For instance, the Calgary Men's Chorus. Mm-hmm. There's Apollo for
fantastic
sports
resource.
And people who are interested in athletics. Gay Friends in Calgary is a resource for people to be able to create contact. There's agencies that particularly work with gay youth. And I think of, I said the name a minute ago, Chris. What was it?
Outlink, was that?
Calgary Outlink, yes, that's the one.
Yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. So there's tons of resources. A matter of picking up Calgary Magazine, Gay Calgary Magazine, mm-hmm. You'll find huge, huge amounts of resources.
Yep. And of course, there's a pickup location here available right on campus, right near East Gate. So yes, if you do need one to pick up a copy here on campus at MRU, yep, they are available. Sorry, continue. Just want to cut that in there.
Cool. I'm going to pass that on because there's just so much more.
Well, mm-hmm. We're now going to go down the ladder and I'll pick this one up. Mm-hmm. Given that we are at Mount Royal University and I know that a lot of other students do listen to this program.
Oh, for sure.
You know, let's start with counseling on campus. You know, sometimes when you are dealing with issues of your own sexuality, just going out into a group of other gay men or gay women, it may be just a bit overwhelming. So, again, you need to be able to you know, get your head around that. And just, you know, the counseling resources on campus are a really helpful start. And then as you move along, the next step is obviously with your family. And PFLAG is an excellent resource.
Absolutely.
It's a peer-based approach. Very, you know, you're going to meet other parents who also have gay children. And you also find a very inclusive environment there that really deals with the family issues quite well.
All right. And Chris, did you want to jump in on this one here?
Yeah. One thing that Bill was mentioning about having friends, I will tell you that one of the big steps between feeling really alone and not feeling alone is just finding just one, just that first gay friend, you know, that, you know, you there's someone else that's just like you and you can talk to them. They're not someone on TV. They're not someone you've read about in the newspaper. They're someone you can talk to and confide in. Mm-hmm. And there's someone else that shares that experience with you. And that's, I found that very powerful. So what he was saying about, you know, like reaching out into the community is something I completely agree with. Calgary Men's Chorus, Apollo, all of those things. Mm-hmm. And what Brian was talking about, you know, counseling on campus. If you're a student here at Mount Royal, full-time students have access to counseling sessions here. It comes in their student fees. There's also a Pride Center in Wickham House if you feel more comfortable speaking to people who are also identifying as or in the community of gay people. And GLBT youth, and there's peer support that can be offered there as well as in the peer support center at the Wickham House. And as Bill was saying, there's Calgary Outlinks, there's Gay Calgary Magazine, Outlooks Magazine, and a whole lot of places. And if you're looking for resources, you can go to the Pride Center at Mount Royal or the Q Center at the University of Calgary or Outlinks, and they will have pamphlets, a directory. There's a directory. I forgot what it's called, but there's a directory of gay services in Calgary.
Yeah, and I'm not sure what it's called either, but it's available.
Yeah, it's available.
And even just going online, type in the words Calgary gay, and you'll get pop, 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 all kinds of stuff. Some of it you don't want to play with.
And what Bill was saying earlier about not going to bars for friends, I do agree, but if you do feel like you need to go, you want to try that as an outlet or a way to make friends, I'd recommend doing things like, you know, they've got special karaoke nights and nights that are not really geared towards dancing and hooking up, but more nights, you know, geared towards socializing and going with the one friend that you have and social networking through a more calm and I guess innocent way.
Absolutely. Going to a gay bar, even going to an event that gay Friends in Calgary does by yourself can be a terrifying experience.
It's intimidating.
It's an extremely intimidating. Yeah, exactly.
An organization like Gay Friends in Calgary, but other organizations as well, you can do contact by email and gain some confidence with one or two of the members through computers or through chatting on the phone with them, and build yourself a small support group that you feel a little bit comfortable with, and then go into the larger world.
There's like tons of resources there. I mean, you just have to really, really dig for it. I mean, I know we always give off the impression we're just this gigantic, big macho town, but no. I mean, it's not. We have a soft center in this case here. So, I think that's probably one way to put it. I think.
You know what, John? I moved here in 2000. I've never had a problem here, and being a visible minority as well as a gay male, and it's been great here.
All right.
You know, Calgary's been. It's a fantastic city for us.
Absolutely. All right. So we got about another minute. So Chris, Bill, would you like to? Who wants to close it off? Or will we go have anything else? Any final pieces of words of advice?
I think the point that's come up very clearly is that mentoring and looking for a mentor is hugely important. But there's another value to that. People, as they age, begin to feel more lonely. And we've concentrated on the suicides of young people, but there are old people who commit suicide because they are left alone. And we miss sometimes a valuable resource in that we could be seeking those people out and learning from them, but also contributing to them.
Absolutely.
And prime time is Calgary, wouldn't that be?
I'm sorry?
Prime Time is Calgary.
Yeah, that's
a very good organization for them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, excellent.
Exactly. And then because, again, they are the... they are sort of, they have the roadmaps. You know what? Honestly, I mean, they are able to walk you through that roadmap as well, too. I mean, I've had a few people who have done that for me as well, too. I mean, that's really, really quite some... They're quite fantastic people. And then you, honestly, don't really need to be afraid of them, honestly. I mean, some of the people I've talked to, they're a little bit afraid of them. But, or like they don't want to have anything to do with them. But yeah, no, they're fantastic advice for sure.
Getting old is not contagious.
Exactly. Yeah, but that seems to be the...
Oh, my.
Yeah.
It's inevitable.
It's an inevitability, but hey, age is just a number, guys. Age is just a number. All right. And there we go. So thank you very much for coming. Bill, Chris, Brian, thank you very much for coming. And thank you for listening. Hopefully we've given you a little bit more advice. So there we go. The current time is now 10:16 a.m. If you're expecting Cecilia on the Six Show this morning, she is away. So it is the Wednesday morning Hump Day Cafe until 12 o'clock, until Brian Allen takes over with the afternoon push. With that said in mind, we're going to bring on some new wave with Marfa and the Muffins and Echo Beach. You're listening to CMRC Radio's Wednesday morning Hump Day Cafe with myself, John Leung, available around the world at cmrcradio.ca.